Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the sixth meeting of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee in session six. Before I can begin, can I remind all those committee members using electronic devices to turn them to silent? I'd also like to apologise for the delay. We had a technical issue, and we'd like to thank the Minister for her patience and the witnesses in other sessions. Our first item of business is consideration of the Forestry Exemption Scotland Amendment Regulations 2021. These regulations are subject to the affirmative procedure, and I refer members to paper one. I welcome Mary McCallan, Minister for Environment and Land Reform, and her officials, Tim Gordon-Roberts, the Regulations Manager for Scottish Forestry, and Amy Hogarth, Solicitor for the Scottish Government. And I invite the Minister to make an opening statement.
Despite the delay, I would still like to just give some opening remarks, hopefully to give an overview to the committee of what we're proposing here. So thanks very much for having me along to discuss the Forestry Exemptions Scotland Amendment Regulations 2021. The 2019 Forestry Exemption Regulations set out the felling activities that can be carried out without a specific felling licence from the regulator, which in this case is Scottish Forestry. The first amendment that I'm proposing today is to correct a minor typographical error in the definition of statutory undertaker, where the word power will be amended to peer, as was originally intended. The second amendment is more substantive. It responds to an unintended consequence resulting from new planning regulations that were laid earlier this year, which created permitted development rights for peatland restoration projects. If not corrected, this could potentially result in the tree felling component of peatland restoration schemes not being given full consideration and proper scrutiny by Scottish Forestry, as of course is supposed to be the case, and at its worst could result in large-scale tree felling as part of a peatland restoration project without sustainable forest management principles having been applied. The unintended consequence was identified during the development of the peatland restoration, the PDR for peatland restoration. The issue was identified and the proposed response that we're tabling today was agreed upon. It was agreed to be a pragmatic way of ensuring that sustainable forest management is fully integrated into the peatland restoration permitted development right. So, applicants for peatland restoration schemes which propose deforestation are already required to obtain an environmental impact assessment from Scottish Forestry. They're also required to apply to the local authority for the permitted development right. The effect of this today will be that they also need to apply to Scottish Forestry for felling permission. On the practicalities of this, very briefly, this can be applied for, the felling permission can be applied for at the same time as requesting that environmental impact assessment that I mentioned, and we would advise that that is done prior to applying to the local authority for the permitted development right. The planning period for peatland restoration PDRs, it's a rigorous process. It requires in-depth surveys and data analysis, and I'm comfortable that there is sufficient time within that process for this additional step of a felling licence to be agreed and obtained. So just to summarise and not to speak for too long, Scottish Government policy and including Scottish Forestry policy supports the restoration of peatlands involving deforestation.
Deforestation.
That the change of land is in line with public benefit and can produce public goods. For example, the obvious is emissions reduction, but there are others, including biodiversity gain and indeed community benefit. So I hope that has explained what we're proposing to do, and I'm content to take any questions.
Thank you, Minister. I now invite questions from members. Alistair.
Based on what you've just said, would it be fair to say that this is an uncontentious piece of legislation?
Yeah, I think that's right, Alistair. Yeah, thank you. I think it is uncontentious because I think it's intuitive that if you are making a peatland restoration project, and it requires deforestation, that you should apply for a felling licence in doing that. And I think that that's actually borne out in the behaviour of a lot of people who have been seeking to use the Peatlands PDR, because one of the things that I've been thinking about, well, is to what extent in the interim period have people applied for Peatlands and this hasn't operated well. I'm aware of two that are ongoing, and one has already begun preparing to apply for the felling licence, albeit that wasn't strictly required, and the other is considering whether it's necessary. So I think it's intuitive and I think it's uncontroversial.
Rachel.
I agree, Minister. I don't think it's controversial in any way. However, I noted that there wasn't an impact study done, an impact assessment, and I just wanted reassurance that to be able to apply for these felling licence in this circumstance, that there was capacity and resource to be able to do it.
Yeah, no, sure, Rachel. You make a good point. The impact assessments across the board were carried out during the development of the Peatland Restoration Permitted Development Right. And on that basis, I'm content that this small amendment, which, as I say, was agreed and the course of to redress it was agreed during that process, is bound up in one of the same. So I'm content that the assessments made then still apply.
Thank you. Can I ask, was there any suggestion that there were bodies out there that were looking to use this loophole to fell trees and not go through the process? Was there any suggestion that that might be the case, and why this has been put in place?
No, thanks, Convener. No, I don't think that is the case. I think that it was from the very beginning recognised as being something which was unintended, and because the course of action to redress it was decided at that point as well, I think that it's always been understood that it shouldn't happen. And I have no evidence that it's been sought to be exploited. In fact, as I was saying to Alistair, two ongoing live applications. For one of them, they're already applying for the felling licence, albeit that it's not strictly required at the moment.
And given the push for peatland restoration to tackle climate change, whatever, do you foresee other pieces of legislation coming forward to ensure that drive to restore more peatland isn't used and for other examples that might be harmful to the environment?
I'm not entirely sure what you mean, Convener, but I think that we would both agree that we have these exceptionally stretching climate targets, and one of the reasons that we can have them is because of the ample opportunity in our natural world to sequester carbon. And in the next 5, 10, 15 years, one of the biggest questions we'll all have to grapple with is about land use and land use change, which best takes us to those targets, but does it fairly and does it in a way that is also good for the nature crisis, is good for communities. And I think it's quite interesting because this is the sort of epitome of that, these two issues coming together and how we balance public benefit.
Okay, thank you. Ariane.
thank you for coming to speak with us today about this subordinate legislation. I'm just curious about any kind of burden that might be put on the Forestry Scotland. They already process felling applications, but I just want to hear if that creates any more burden. And the kind of underlying piece of my question is just understanding from my other committee, the planning departments. So this whole kind of like licensing or permitting seems to be a very stretched area. And I'm quite concerned about that because, you know, going forward, we're going to be shaping Scotland for the next, you know, in this session, we're shaping Scotland for the next 20 plus years. And it's just making sure that departments are resourced properly, staffed and resourced properly to do that work.
No, thank you, Ariane, for that point. And I agree, of course, as peatland restoration grows in popularity, as we do what we need to do in forestry and planting, pressure does mount on the folks that need to consider the applications. In this circumstances, I'm absolutely confident that Scottish Forestry have the capacity to take on what they'll be required to as part of this. And actually, this takes weight off of the local authorities, because in the interim period, without the requirement for the felling licence to be applied to Scottish Forestry, it would have fallen to the local authority to consider it. And therefore, this correction allows it to go back to Scottish Forestry, who I'm confident can manage it.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. No further questions. We'll now move to agenda item 2, subordinate legislation and the formal consideration of the motion to approve the instrument. And I invite Ms McCallan to move the motion for S6M-01170.
Moved, convener. Thank you.
Thank you. Does any member wish to debate the motion? No? Okay. Is the committee content to recommend approval of the instrument? And finally, is the committee content to delegate authority to me to sign off our report or on deliberations on this affirmative SSI? Thank you. And that completes consideration of the affirmative instrument. I'd like to thank the Minister for her patience and our officials for attending today. Thank you.
Thank you all.
We'll now briefly suspend to allow you a changeover of witnesses.